Now we're going to start with a little quiz today. Is that okay? And here are some of the rules. The first rule is no person can answer any more than one question. So you only get to answer one question. And I'm just going to tell you that the questions get harder. So as we go along. So if you want to volunteer, you probably should volunteer sooner rather than later. But my first question is, how many books are in the Bible? Who'd like to tell me? Sister Ann, okay, go ahead. Sister. 66. Can anyone tell us the names of those books in order? Oh, wait a minute now. I got a little slow here. Wait a minute. They don't get easier, friends. Come on. Okay, I'll make this one an easy one. Who is our Savior?
Jesus.
That's right, Jesus. Who can tell me what the Bible definition for sin is? Ashley?
Transgression of law.
Transgression of law. Who knows where the text is? Anyone? 1 John 3:4. What does the first commandment say? Thou shalt have
no other God before me.
And the fifth commandment says, honor thy father and thy mother, which is the first commandment with promise. Can anyone give me just a short definition of justification? Don't be afraid. Alan.
Righteousness by faith.
Righteousness by faith. Well, that's a good start. I like that. Righteousness by faith. And we could include sanctification in with righteousness by faith too, couldn't we? Well, we could talk about these things in more details. But I want to tell you in times past, and not in just Adventism, but in the Reformed churches, what they call the Reformed churches. You know. Any 7-year-old could have answered all those questions because they were part of the catechisms that they learned. They learned basic fundamentals about the Bible and justification. And, you know, and I'm not saying that they understood every nuance or aspect of it like we could understand it today. But the children were taught these basic fundamental truths, and they knew them in an early age. And I'm not sure how well my son Hans would have done with all these questions at 7, but I know when he was 4 years old, he knew all the books of the Bible. That's very true. But today, fewer and fewer children raised in homes where Christianity is professed will continue to be Christians when they leave. And in fact, it's estimated today that only about 1 in 3 children remain Christians, or remain active, professed Christians, even though they grew up in Christian homes. Something is wrong. Today, among our youth, 63% don't believe Jesus is the Son of the true God. 58% believe that all faiths teach equally valid truths. 51% don't believe Jesus rose from the dead. 65% don't believe in a real, literal devil. And when young people lack a system of biblical belief, they are twice as likely to be angry with life or to feel like life lacks purpose. They are twice as likely to be disappointed in life, 48% more likely to cheat on an exam, twice as likely to steal, twice as likely to physically hurt someone, 3 times more likely to take illicit drugs, and 6 times more likely to take their lives in suicide. Now I'd like to invite you to open your Bibles with me to Deuteronomy chapter 6. Deuteronomy chapter 6. And what I'm going to be talking about today, while it has a main application for those of us who may have family situations, is applicable to every individual, whether we are living as individuals or living as families, whether we have children, whether we don't have children or not. You'll see how it works. Deuteronomy chapter 6. And if I just said, we're only going to read one verse in Deuteronomy chapter 6, I bet most of you would be able to guess what verse I start with. What verse would I start with? What?
4.
Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. You know that verse quite well, don't you? But it's not all that's in connection with it. And in fact, if we look at the context of it and the application of this now. So let's read verses 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9 also. And we're going to come back and talk a little bit about them. Starting again in verse 4, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul, and with all thy might. And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thy heart. And thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. Verse 8. And thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thy hand, and they shall be as frontlets between thine eyes. And thou shalt write them upon the posts of thy house and on thy gates. Think about those words for just a minute. We call verse 4 the Shema of Israel. Hear. Shema is the Hebrew word for hear. And we are told in Hosea 4:6, he says, my people perish for what? Lack of knowledge. And Jesus in John 17:3 said, this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, in Jesus Christ whom thou hast sent. But you know there's another text. There's another text. It's in James chapter 2, verse 19. And I bet you all know what it says. It says, thou believest there's one God, thou doest what?
Well.
But it doesn't end there, does it, Alan? It says, the devils also believe and tremble. We need a knowledge of God, friends, but we need more than just a superficial dictionary knowledge of these things. We have to really know God. And the first true commandment, and Jesus said it was the first commandment, is to hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God, as it says here in verse 5, with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy might. This is the first and greatest of all commandments. And he says in verse 6 here in Deuteronomy 6, and these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart. In thine heart. Remember in Psalm 119, David said, thy word have I hidden in mine heart, that I might not sin against thee. He says, wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his ways? By taking heed thereto according to thy word. We have to have God's word in our hearts, and those of us who are parents or those of us who are raising children or have any influence with young people. It tells us in verse 7 that we are to teach them diligently. Now, I realize that some of us have children who aren't home anymore, but they're still our children, aren't they? And they may not be in our homes anymore, but anything we can do to teach them and to inculcate the Word of God into their hearts, we should do. But here in this particular verse, and in this context, it seems to be speaking about, you know, parents who have children who are still at home, perhaps young children who are growing up. And he says very plainly, you shall talk of them when thou sittest in thy house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. How was the parent going to teach the Word of God to the younger generation? And is this command valid today? Can we do this, and must we do it? I'd like to propose to you that we can't do it when we're driving somewhere with our children and we're talking on our cell phones all the time. And it says when you go in the way, when you're here, when you're there, we should be trying to figure out how to inculcate the Word of God into our young people. And we can't do that if we're preoccupied with other things. Now, we may be teaching them how to make a cake. We may be teaching them how to build a house. We may be doing a lot of things. But while we do those things, are we teaching them about the Word of God, about God, His principles? You know, how we do this carefully. We do this right because we do all things unto the Lord. In Counsels to Teachers on page 110, we are told this. In the church at home, you just stop there. We think we're a church today. But the fundamental church, of the big church, of the whole church, is the church at home. This is the true foundation, is the church at home. In the church at home, the children are to learn to pray and to trust in God. Well, I thought that's why we sent them to Sabbath school, Alan. We sent them to Sabbath school so they can learn those things. Well, certainly we can try to reinforce it and teach it if they're not getting it at home. But friends, at the home is where they learn this. It says, teach them to repeat God's law. That means we need to memorize God's law, friends. It says, come in humility with a heart full of tenderness and with a sense of the temptations and dangers before yourselves and your children. By faith, bind them to the altar and treat for them the care of the Lord. Train the children to offer their simple words of prayer. Tell them that God delights to have them call upon Him. And then in volume 5 of the Testimonies on page 423, we are told, my brethren, are you cultivating devotion? Is love of religious things, what's that word? Prominent. What does that mean? Prominent.
First,
foremost. Is it important? Are you living by faith and overcoming the world? Do you attend the public worship of God? And are your voices heard in the prayer and social meeting? Let me just pause there. When Ellen White speaks about a social meeting, in her time and her terminology, what was a social meeting? Was it a place where you got together and played games? A social meeting? No, a social meeting was a testimony meeting. It was a testimony meeting where people gave testimonies. Let me continue. Is the family altar established? Well, what is a family altar? We'll talk about it in a minute. She says, is the family altar established? Do you gather your children together morning and evening and present their cases to God? Do you instruct them how to become followers of the Lamb? Your families, if irreligious, testify to your neglect and unfaithfulness. And so, beloved, putting all this, I believe, into the context of today, for those who are currently raising children, I'd like to ask, is God's Word the topic at your breakfast table and at your dinner table? Are you taking time to discuss God's Word with your family? As the head of the home, men, are you doing your responsibility? When we go to the store with our children and they're in the car with us, do we speak about God and His Word on the way, or are we too busy with our cell phones or listening to some piece of music that we like? Are we talking to our young people about life, creation, relationships? Are you weaving God's Word into every conversation? And in Deuteronomy here, in Deuteronomy 6, verses 8 and 9, he speaks about having these, the law. It says, to bind them for signs upon thy hands, and they shall be as frontlets between thy eyes, and put them upon the posts of the door, and so on your gates. And the Jews took some of this very literally. You know, they would have these little boxes, and they would have scrolls of the different verses in it, and they would even hang some of these from their foreheads, you know, so it could be there. But I believe that an understanding for this today would call for us to have our homes as a sanctuary for God's Word, and for our homes to be beacons of light. You know, if you place something on a doorpost, and by the way, I saw this, I noticed in Brazil, two or three homes I was at, they had the Ten Commandments on little sticker magnets on the refrigerator, you know. But maybe we don't all go past the refrigerator. But we all go through the doorposts as we go in and out, I suppose. But I'd like to say that in our lives and our witnesses, we are to make it known to our neighbors that our homes are a place where God's Word is taught and where truth abides, a place that is known to raise children by God's standards, a place that holds daily, morning and evening, family worship. And there's a special time for this, and we join with the fellowship of believers at least once a week in worship as we are here today. As we read in the scriptures about Deuteronomy 6, I think it's easy to miss a very important observation, and that there are three statements in verses 4 through 6 concerning our relationship with God. And the first one is that there is one true God. God is one. God is not a multitude of individuals. Secondly, we are to love God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. And thirdly, we are to have God's love upon our heart and His Word in our heart. And I believe that these are placed in these verses before the instruction is given to us in verses 7, 8, 9. So that we could be understanding what the requirements, if you please, for teaching are. Before we teach our children, we have to meet these criteria if you please, or before we teach the younger generation. We must live and know these commands. And if there is apathy in your life toward God and God's Word, it simply doesn't matter then. It doesn't matter to you, and it's not going to matter to your children. And they can see, and they understand. Children are very good learners, and sometimes they're better teachers than we are. Have you ever seen children manipulate their parents? You've probably never seen that. Sure. Our children aren't usually very stupid. And if they see apathy in us, they're going to reflect it most times. They will develop a laziness, an apathy, mediocrity, if you please, for spiritual things. And worship at church or studying the Sabbath school, friends, is not the answer alone. The foundation must be in our homes. We generally think of a child staying at home for about 18 years. 18 years. What can happen in 18 years? If your child is in your home for 18 years, it says here that you will have 13,148 occasions for personal and or family worship. So even if you don't have children at home in 18 years, you have 13,148, and that's counting for four leap years, by the way, in that 18 years, occasions for a morning and an evening worship. If you learn a new hymn or psalm each month, you'll be exposed to 216 new hymns. Wouldn't that be nice? Just one each month. If you read a chapter out of the Bible at each worship, you will complete the Bible 9 times. Wouldn't it be wonderful that your children had the Bible read to them 9 times as they grew up? And some are reading The Conflict of the Ages through right now. It's a wonderful series. There's 320 chapters. When I say Conflict of the Ages, it means patriarchs and prophets, prophets and kings, Desire of Ages, Acts of the Apostles, and the book Great Controversy. 320 chapters. If you just simply read enough that you complete one chapter a week in those worship sessions, you will complete that series through 3 times. 3 times. What a foundation that you have as an opportunity to give your family. And all this can be done as something that Ellen White calls the family altar. By the way, you know most homes do have altars in them, don't you? Almost every home in America has an altar. It looks something like this. It's called the television. Sure it is. Have you ever heard of someone by the name of Anton LaVey? I'm sure that name is familiar to you. Who is he?
Founder of the Worldwide Church of Satan.
Yeah, that's right. And it's interesting what he said. He said the TV set or satanic family altar has grown more elaborate since the early 50s. He called the TV the Satanic Family Altar. I found this little cartoon I thought was interesting. The man's bowing down to the TV and it's crunching out greed, mocking doubt, lust, cursing, hate, Satan, violence, sloth, death, pride. And he says, "Oh, great giver of fun and fantasy, oh, almighty master of our time and opinions, wouldst thou permit us to partake of sun prayer and Bible study tonight for a change?" And the good wife holding the TV guide, she says, "I think it's okay, dear. It says here in the Word that there's no good shows on tonight." This isn't what God has in mind for family altars. And it's not something like this either. Here we have a picture of like a Catholic altar in a home. And you see there's a crucifix, an idol of Mary, there's candles burning, a rosary, and so on. That's not what God has in mind either. But he does have something in mind when he speaks about a family altar. A family altar is a place in the home where the family gathers to worship God and to seek the blessings of heaven. And it may be a place that you establish at the kitchen table. It may be a table in your living room that has an open family Bible on it. But it's a place that the family knows this is where we gather when we worship at home. This is where we gather to seek God and to pray. In Genesis chapter 12 and verse 8, it speaks about Abraham. And it says, "And there he built an altar to the Lord and called upon the name of the Lord." Everywhere Abraham went, he built an altar. And that's where he worshiped. And it's where he brought his family, immediate and larger family, of his household in to worship. We are told in Patriarchs and Prophets, good book, page 128, Abraham, the friend of God, set us a, what kind of example does it say? Worthy example. His was a life of prayer. Wherever he pitched his tent, close beside it was set up his altar, calling all within his encampment to the morning and evening sacrifice. Now, Ellen White speaks about this concept that we mentioned of a family altar. And in counsels to teachers here again, on page 110, she says, in every Christian home, God should be honored by the morning and evening sacrifices of prayer and praise. Children should be taught to respect and reverence the hour of prayer. It is the duty of Christian parents, morning and evening, by earnest prayer and persevering faith, to make a hedge about their children. She says that we should not neglect this. In My Life Today, on page 34, she says, those who profess the name of Christ should not neglect to establish the family altar, where they can seek God daily with all the earnestness with which they would seek Him in a religious assembly. Some place in their home they establish where they come together for prayer. It's not a common place of the house. Those of you who know me and have been down to my house, you know I have a little table down there. And on that table I have a lambskin with a Bible on top of it. And we don't put our food on that table. If we're coming into the living room to sit down and eat, we don't put our plates on that table. We don't put our drinks on that table because it's a sacred table in my home. It's the family altar that I have. It's my little altar where I can seek God and we come together for people in my home to worship. Ellen White says every home should have something like this. Do you believe that? Well, let me read it to you. Here we are. Child Guidance, page 517. Every family should rear its altar of prayer, realizing that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Now, just setting up a place doesn't mean anything unless you use it, you see. It doesn't mean anything unless you use it. You come together there to pray and to worship. She says, every family should rear its altar of prayer, realizing that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. If any persons in the world need the strength and encouragement that religion gives, it is those who are responsible for the education and training of children. They cannot do their work in a manner acceptable to God while their daily example teaches those who look to them for guidance that they can live without God. In other words, you can't live without God properly. It says, if they educate their children to live for this life only, they will make no preparation for eternity. They will die as they have lived without God, and parents will be called to account for the loss of their souls. Fathers and mothers, you need to seek God morning and evening at the family altar that you may learn how to teach your children wisely, tenderly, lovingly. Many parents today, they save money when their children are young so that they can send them to college and get a preparation for life. And I'm not saying that there's anything wrong with education. In fact, as parents, we have a responsibility to train our children or to make sure that they have training so that they can become self-sufficient. The one purpose, the one fundamental purpose of parenting is to train your children to live without you. But that means not only physically, but it means spiritually above all. That they can develop a personal relationship with Jesus Christ based upon what they've learned in their homes. So that when they leave your home, their faith doesn't stay there with it, but it leaves with them. In volume 5 of the Testimonies, on page 416, she says, the youth who show respect for sacred and holy things learn these lessons under the home roof. Before the world is placed upon the soul, it's marked the image of sin, deceit, and dishonesty. Love to God is learned at the family altar of the father and mother in very babyhood. Some of us know someone who's going to be soon. Precious. And this is the time to teach them when they're babies. We now know that children, we know scientifically now, that children recognize the voice of the mother as soon as they're born because they've been listening to it. We know that they have certain skills have learned, that they've learned already in the womb. My, maybe I should recalculate my figures for 18 years and 9 months. But anyhow. Now, as I was studying this through and thinking about this, something popped out at me as I was reading through the Spirit of Prophecy that I wasn't looking for at all. And it was this. That many times when Ellen White was given a vision, the context is that it was done not just at church always, but it was done more at home around what she called the family altar. Let me just give you an example. In fact, the first one is her very first vision that she ever had. It was not long after the passing of time in 1844 that my first vision was given me. I was visiting a dear sister in Christ whose heart was knit with mine. 5 of us, all women, were kneeling quietly at where? They had a family alternate home. And that's where they were kneeling for prayer. And while we were praying, she says, the power of God came upon me as I never felt it before. Testimonies for the Church, Volume 1, page 58. In Life Sketches, just a couple examples. Life Sketches, the 1888 edition, on page 280. While engaged in prayer around the family altar, I was taken off in vision. And then later she says, the next morning, while at family prayer, I was taken off in vision. And that family prayer was done at the family altar. That's right. Not only was Ellen White blessed in this way, but she speaks of James White, her husband. Notice this. This is from Volume 3 of the Testimonies, page 174. Volume 3, page 174. But one morning in prayer at the family altar, the Spirit of God came upon him, referring to her husband James White, as he was praying for divine guidance in matters pertaining to the Institute. And he explained why, bowed upon his knees, the Lord will vindicate every word he has spoken through vision relative to the Health Institute, and it will be raised from its low estate and prosper gloriously. At that time, the Health Institute seemed like it was going to fold. They didn't know how they could keep going any longer. And they were praying, and the Lord gave Ellen White a vision that this was going to prosper, and of course it did. It prospered greatly. But he got this at the family altar as they were praying there, and I thought that was interesting. Ellen White, she speaks about her practice, and this is from the book Faith and Works, page 69. We do not realize the 1,000 dangers that our Heavenly Father has kept us from. We do not realize the great blessing that He has bestowed upon us in giving us food and raiment, in preserving our lives by sending the guardian angels to watch over us. Every day we should be thankful for this. And then she says, we ought to gather around the family altar every day and praise Him for His watch care over us. The children of Israel had lost sight that God was protecting them from the venomous beasts, but when He withdrew His hand, their sting was upon them. And sometimes, friends, we do the same thing. We become complacent. And we fail to remember what God is doing for us and see what God is doing for us. And sometimes He lifts His protection, He lifts His mercy off of us, and then we have all these problems and we wonder why. God is trying to shake us, friends, and wake us up in the most gentle, kind way He can. But she says here, we ought to have gratitude stirring in our hearts and come to God with a gratitude offering every day. And we do this, she says, at the family altar. Now, what do you do? You have a practical situation. What do you do when you have guests? What do you do when you have guests come into your home? And maybe these people aren't religiously inclined. Well, we're told in Volume 6 of the Testimonies on page 347 this. At the family board and the family altar, the guests are made welcome. The season of prayer makes its impression on those who receive entertainment, and even one visit may mean the saving of a soul from death. For this work, the Lord makes a reckoning, saying, I will repay. You can't force your guests to come to your family worship time, but you don't neglect it because you have guests, and you always invite them to participate. And if they do, she says, just one time may make the difference of the saving of that soul. Something Brother Ford taught me, I've appreciated, it's meant a lot to me. Think of a balance scale for just a minute. Okay. We don't know how many billions of people have ever lived on this earth, but who knows, in the billions at least. And you put everyone who's ever going to be lost on one side. And you add up how many years they lived on this earth. It will be so many billion or quadrillion or something. And you just take one soul and put it on the other side. And throughout eternity, that one soul's life will outweigh everyone else who was ever lost. Combined. That one soul's important, friends. We're told in volume 5, 416, love to God is learned at the family altar of the father and mother in very babyhood. In Ministry of Healing 392, in a sense, the father is the priest of the household, laying upon the family altar the morning and evening sacrifice. And men, that's our great responsibility. And if the men aren't there, the men fail to do it, the women have to pick it up. I understand that, ladies. But this is a responsibility. And also on the next page, 393, Ellen White says this, fathers and mothers, however pressing your business, you know, it's canning season, there's a lot to get done, or it's Friday, there's so much preparation to do, or it's just before school and we have so many things to get ready. She says, fathers and mothers, however pressing your business, do not fail to gather your family around God's altar. And I'm thinking about this because sometimes, you know, we're out on a trip, we come back so late. And it's too late to seemingly have worship. And so we just put everybody to bed and we go to bed. And I'm thinking, you know, next time I want to arrange my schedule so that it doesn't have to be so pressed. Because this is important. This is more important than making the schedule. Because this is the schedule. Remember that your dear ones are exposed to temptations. Daily annoyances beset the path of young and old. Those who would live patient, loving, cheerful lives must pray. Only by receiving constant help from God can we gain the victory over self. And we all need that. In the book, In Heavenly Places, we're told on page 90, and yet in this time of fearful peril, some who profess to be Christians have no family altar. They do not honor God in the home, nor teach their children to love and fear Him. Let that be said about us. What do you say, beloved? Now, I want to shift gears just for a little bit, and then we'll close. Okay, fair? Do you believe that we're living in peril times of peril today, perilous times today? Do you believe that we're living in last day times today? I do. I really do. Have you ever heard of something called Chimera? Chimera? Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Michael has. Those of us who are familiar with Bible prophecy know that, for instance, in the book of Daniel, there's a lion that has wings, a leopard with four wings and four heads. There's some great and terrible beast, and then in Revelation 13, there's this composite beast that has bear, leopard, lion parts. And we might think, you know, that the people who read those verses when Daniel and then later John wrote those verses, that maybe that was an astounding new idea to see some kind of a hybrid animal like that. But it wasn't at all. It wasn't at all new to those people. Because ancient civilizations had these concepts of hybrid animals. You go back to Babylon and there you see bulls with human heads and winged bulls and things on the gates and stuff that were uncovered by archaeologists. We know that even as early as over 1080 BC when Homer was writing, he was speaking of something called Chimera. And what it was in Greek mythology, it was a fire-breathing female monster with a lion's head, a goat's body, and a serpent's tail, and sometimes a goat's head also coming out of the body as well. But today there's a new field of so-called science, and it's called Chimera. And it's biologically organisms containing a mixture of genetically different tissues formed by process such as fusion of early embryos and with stem cells. The DNA molecule was sequenced derived from two or more different organisms formed by laboratory manipulation. And what's happening right now is, right now, on the 4th of this month, the 4th of August, 2016, the National Health Institute released a report saying that they were considering lifting their ban on research about Chimera. In other words, that they would now be willing possibly to financially support the research and study of a project like this. And there's a 30-day, we're in the part near the tail end right now of a 30-day waiting period for people to respond or to object or to somehow speak toward this right now to the NIH here in the United States. And so far, the evidence appears to look very strongly like they're going to, at the end of the 30 days or sometime shortly thereafter, they're going to lift the moratorium that they have on it. Now, why do people want to do this? Why do they want to take the embryo, for instance, of a pig and put human stem cells into it? Remember this, human stem cells are so unique and so special because they can become literally any cell in your body. They have the ability to grow into bones, they can grow into muscles, they can grow into organs, they can grow into many things. And so the idea is, here's what we could do. If we could take these human stem cells and put into animals, they could grow organs that might work more like human organs. And so if there's a medical treatment, a procedure, or a drug that we want to test that we think might help humans, maybe heart problems or kidney problems or liver problems, but where we don't really want to try these drugs out on people first, well, we could try them out on these animals that have a heart that works something like a human heart. But they want to do more. They're thinking yet beyond that, well, what if we could actually grow a human heart in a pig? Or a human liver in a pig? Because every day in the United States, 7,000 people die who need organ transplants but can't get them because they're just not available. 7,000 every day. Today, while we're talking, several hundreds will die just in the hour that we're talking right now because they can't get an organ transplant. And if we could grow these hearts or these livers or these kidneys or these lungs enough like human ones or even just like human ones, we could use them for transplant. But of course, it doesn't stop there. Because these stem cells, friends, they can become any other kind of cell. And that includes nerve cells that make up your brain. And so what happens if we perform this test and all of a sudden now we maybe have a pig or a dog or some kind of animal that develops what looks like a human brain? What if it develops a type of human consciousness? Or what if we can't tell? But it does. Now what happens? Or what if it were to develop a fully functional human brain? How do we treat this animal? Do we harvest its organs? Do we treat it like a human being? Can you see the moral and the ethical implications of this are tremendous? And they're not good. But they actually want to do this. In fact, there are scientists who say, we'd like to grow human brains, human-type brains in these animals, so we could do research on Alzheimer's disease and dementia and things like that. And furthermore, what if these animals were to develop reproductive systems that could produce human ovaries or human sperm? They might be a pig that could give birth to a human creature, human-like creature. I mean, this is just, and the fact is there are scientists who want to do that very thing, to study infertility issues. Now, with that background, I'm going to read you something. This is from Spirit of Prophecy, Volume 1, page 69. If there was one sin above another which called for the destruction of the race by the flood, it was the base crime of amalgamation of man and beast which defaced the image of God and caused confusion everywhere. For over 100 years, Adventists have been debating, discussing what Ellen White really meant by this statement. When she says amalgamation of man and beast, did she mean amalgamation of men with men and beast with beast? Or did she mean amalgamation of men somehow genetically being fused with beasts? And been a lot of discussion on that. No one was not here to answer exactly what she meant. But I would like to say that even if it was simply men with men and beasts with beasts, even if it was only that, she condemned it. But here what we are seeing happening today is clearly amalgamation of human and animal genetics together. And my Bible tells me that God does not change. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And He is no respecter of persons. And if this was a base crime that He destroyed this world for, He's going to do it again, friends. And it's going to happen soon. And that's why it's important that we rekindle the fire and get our spiritual lives together. That's why we need to have morning and evening prayer, because, friends, we can know these things, and just knowing them doesn't help us. The devil believes and he trembles. Right? And Isaiah 33. Isaiah 33. And in verse 14, God makes a statement, and then He asks a question too. Isaiah 33, 14. He says, "The sinners in Zion are afraid. Fearfulness has surprised the hypocrites." Now that's, of course, what we call parallel language there. But I want to ask you a question. Who in this verse does it say is afraid?
Sinners.
Both answers are right. But it's together. It's the sinners in the church. Zion represents the people of God, right? It's not talking about, you know, Jesus in Luke 21, He spoke about fearfulness upon, you know, man's hearts filling them for fear for the things coming upon the earth, right? But that's not the same thing that this is speaking of. This is speaking about people in His church or those who profess to be His people. That's the ones, He says, are afraid. And fearfulness has surprised the hypocrite. And then He asks an important question. He says, "Who among us shall dwell with the devouring fire? Who among us shall dwell with everlasting burnings?" Because the Bible says, our God, and I believe it's in Hebrews 12:29, also in the Old Testament number, our God is a what? Consuming fire. Yeah, friends, you don't live very easily in consuming fire, do you? We're going to do a little experiment. Let's move these things out of my way here. We're going to do a little experiment. I have here some alcohol. You ever have an alcohol stove? Have you used an alcohol stove? This is 70% isopropyl alcohol. I'm going to pour just a little bit in a container here, and I'll make it so you can see it better. I think I'll do it right here. I'll risk your piano then. And I have here a $100 bill. It's real. The real McCoy. See the watermarks and all the shreds, and look at it under the magnifying glass. But I think it's so important you understand this that I'm willing to burn up $100 bills.
I should be able to see,
So we're going to take this bill and we're going to soak it in this alcohol. And we've removed the, maybe we haven't removed the battery from the fire detector. But Alan, I need you to come up and help me with this, if you would, please. You're a good helper. And what I need you to do is take a match. I want you to burn this bill up for me. I'll hold it. Just strike a match to it. There we go. Okay. So we're going to burn up this $100 bill so you can see what we're talking about here. And what happened to it? It didn't burn up, did it? But it was in fire, but it didn't burn up. Why didn't it burn up?
Alcohol burns at a lower temperature than it takes to burn paper.
Well, actually, if I put this in pure alcohol, guy, it's going to burn. But because it has some water in it, the water protects the bill, and it doesn't evaporate before the alcohol burns up, because the alcohol burns fast. So we still have our $100. It actually belongs to you.
Oh, dear, John.
It's not your money. It's ministry money, but I would have replaced it if it went far. Science project went south, I would have replaced it somehow. Now, let's open our Bibles back to Isaiah 33. And it says, who among us shall dwell with everlasting burnings? And in verse 15 it tells us, he that walketh righteously and speaketh uprightly, he that despises the gain of oppression, that shaketh his hands from holding of bribes, that stoppeth his ears from hearing of blood, and shutteth his eyes from seeing evil. He shall dwell on high, his place of defense shall be the munition of rocks, bread shall be given him, his water shall be sure. Friends, I'd like to propose to you that those who walk righteously, those who speak uprightly, those who keep their eyes from seeing the violence, who stop their ears from hearing the blood, these are the people who are going to be having their worship time every morning and evening. These are the people who are forming this experience with God that we're not going to get if we don't. You know, it's easy to turn on a television and you can condemn the television all you want. Like Brother Elvis told me this last week, he says, you know, in Curacao we use machetes a lot. Machete, you know what a machete is. A very useful tool. He says, but you can hack someone's head off with one too if you want. It's just a matter of how you use the tool. But television itself is not intrinsically evil. The internet is not intrinsically evil, and the computer is not intrinsically evil, but the way most people use them today, it is evil. And it is wrong. And we worship at those things. We spend so much time when they're before our God. And we make idols and gods out of them. But are we spending time in these fearful last days, fearful last days, and preparing our hearts and the hearts of our families, everyone that we can have an influence in who comes into our home, to be ready for heaven? Because just one visit, just one time at that altar, may be the saving difference between heaven and hell for that person. And if we don't have that habit, if we don't have that custom, if you please, in our homes, if it's not become part of our life, then we're not going to do it. We don't need to be ashamed of anything in our homes, friends. We don't need to be ashamed of having a family altar and prayer, and that the Word of God is important in our home. We should never be ashamed of that. We should be thankful it is. And we're either going to do it or we're not going to do it. And if we're not going to do it, friends, we're not going to do God's program. We're not going to be in heaven. It's that simple. May God bless us. May God bless us, friends, to rekindle that fire so that we can dwell in devouring fire.